We'll start with our technical session one, which is food technology in food processing sector, its status and needs.
To welcome the speakers for the technical session one, which is devoted for food technologies in food processing sector, what is the status and their needs? We have fortunately very good speakers in this particular session. Mr. Sanjeev Gupta, he has been the association president of Agro and Food Processing Equipment and Technology Provider Association of India. A very wide experience, and the most important part of this food technology processing sector is what are the kind of equipments that are actually needed? Are we able to manufacture them? Are we able to import them? What are those lacunes? What kind of innovations have been done in them? We have now the second speaker is from Patanjali Ayurveda. Actually, earlier I was told that Mr. Surendra Sharma was to come, but in his place, Mr. Krishna Narvade has already joined. Welcome, Krishnaji, for this particular session. We have third speaker is Nagaich, Radveer Nagaich. He is from Niti Aayog. And he's a senior policy consultant. I think we have to hear from him. What are the new policies possibly that would emanate from government in this particular sector? And the last speaker is Ramesh Srivastav, who is from CMAP, that is in Lucknow institution, which has also several branches in Bangalore and Hyderabad and other places which are doing a lot of research in the medicinal and aromatic plant. So a very diversified, very big group that we have in this particular sector. I think I would like to request each speaker, if they want to make a presentation, perfectly okay, they can. But kindly restrict it to 20, 22 minutes. I will just give a hint at about 20 minutes so that we will get at the end a few questions who are participating. Because these are what our experience in the last webinars which we have conducted, lot of questions normally come in our agriculture supply chain management, farmer producing organization, scope of farm mechanization. These are some of our topics which we find that lot of activities have come. And food safety standard. So that also is another area. But I would like this particular session where we devote more time. What are those new food technologies? Can we use those new technologies and improve our status today? Because as I said, I think my first even introductory topic which I said is about surplus management. That today the problem with the farmers who are not getting enough price is mainly because of surplus. See, on one side farmers are producing, technologies are available, but the other side there is no utilization. In America, I remember once they had a lot of food. So what they do is they gave what is called as a fallow land subsidy. Probably you don't grow, we'll give you a subsidy. I think that kind of thing with them. But here now we can convert a lot of agriculture, primary food into secondary and tertiary agriculture. I think this is what we are looking for in this technology. May I now may I request Sanjeev Gupta is around? Mr. Sanjeev Gupta?
Yeah.
Mr. Sanjeev, can you just start your...
thank you, Dr. Mai, and all my all the distinguished speakers and delegates. It was nice to hear the talk by Honorable Minister, Dr. Mr. Nitin Gadkari, who is known for his dynamic approach and who is always setting a benchmark of performance of departments of the minister of which he is. It always becomes a benchmark. It is good that he is taking so much of interest in this segment, and I'm sure it will mean a positive result. Without wasting more time, I would like to first try to say that what is the status of the food processing industry in India? As we all know, I firmly believe that the food processing industry in India is one of the most sunrise industry or segment of this country. India, as we all know, is an agricultural economy, and this is the only segment which connects the agriculture to the consumer through value addition process. And this is a great tool to increase the income at the agriculture level and all through the chain, and also is in a position to provide healthy food even to the consumer if the right technology utilized. And nonetheless, it is the biggest opportunity to provide employment, which our country needs the most because of our population. Now, it is expected that by the year 2025-26, $535 billion would be the market of the Indian food processing sector. So it has huge potential, which we are looking at. So talking about technologies, we have made rapid progress in technologies for food processing sector over the last few years. I would say that this is not a very old segment. The real development of this segment has started from late 90s till today. So, but in this period also, we have made rapid developments, and we can't say that the Indian industry or the Indian in the food machinery sector has developed all the technologies. We are largely importing also. And the imports, I would say, is more on the high capacity kind of production or some extra value addition. As far as the basic processing is concerned, Indian, we have indigenous technology well developed, and there is no problem in providing that technology. So where lies the gap? You know, I have certain I would like everybody to draw their attention on the fact that one of the sectors in the food processing which has grown tremendously is the snacks sector, whether we like it or not, but it has grown tremendously. And it has got a direct connection with the agricultural produce, like potatoes, from which potato chips are made, or various kind of pulses from which flours are made, which are major ingredients. Now here you will see that the value addition has been tremendous, and in potatoes, where the processing variety of potatoes, wherever it is being farmed, has got a very good return to the farmers, and this segment is growing rapidly and is always a short supply. Similarly, in the pulses, the situation is thus that we are importing now because we don't have the right quantity and quality available always. So I would like to say that we need a holistic approach where we can address the need of this segment, where the farmers are benefited, and right up to the value chain, the consumer is benefited. We are still lacking. Where are we lacking is the availability of the right raw material of adequate quality at the right place and at the right time. This, I think, this requires more of planning and removing the unbalance in the demand supply chain, some advanced farming methods. We require more consistent quality of raw materials, which really can be used for processing, and we require a holistic approach that how investments can happen right at the farm level, where I have traveled all over the world, where I have seen that the investment is happening more at the growing level, where the produce which is grown is processed, cleaned, and made ready for consumption to the industry at different grades of quality, so that at the industry level, they don't have to face inconsistent quality in processing, because they are investing a huge sum of money in setting up the plants for processing. And there, if they get inconsistent quality, then the whole objective is lost. So I feel that at the farm level, how investments can happen, as somebody said before me, that they're talking about farm entrepreneurship. Yes, that is what we require. Technology availability is not an issue. It is growing. Every day new technologies are getting developed in India. It is need-based situation as well, that when more and more need comes, the technology gets developed faster. We have a lot of incubation time required for the technology to get proven. There we require support from the government as well, because our technology machinery sector, you know, actually speaking, we don't know we fall under which ministry. It should be coming, according to me, it should be coming under the Ministry of Food Processing. Then only we can get the same kind of recognition and support, which can help in developing more and more technologies and also getting technologies from abroad. Today, what we are doing is totally need-based, as the need is coming from the industry, that gets more priority than probably the need at the farming sector is something different. So this disbalance or unbalance needs to be removed, for which a more holistic approach is required. The snack industry is one which has adopted the high technology and has grown tremendously in India. And each and every raw material and ingredient has become a shortage, and all the Indian produce is getting totally consumed. This is what I know of. And similarly, the area where we require more kind of a focus is on the fruits and vegetable sector, because right at the farm end or at the harvesting, and I am told that we have nearly 30% of wastage. Now, this wastage is basically happening because I feel that there's not a concerted approach at that level, at the harvesting and farming level, so that this waste does not happen. If this waste can be removed, I think the income for the farmers can also increase tremendously. For this, basically, approach is, or a policy is required, where the farmer and the industry gets connected and there is a win-win situation for all concerned. I think I would like to, at the moment, say this much, and if any more questions or any more deliberations happen, I can join once again. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gupta. I think you have raised the concern very well. Very clear, as you said, that there are issues which are very important. For example, I'm sure I was talking about surplus things, but then what surplus we have is, again, is not of quality. It's not the quantity that is important now. I think when we talk about food industry, the processing varieties are very important. I think I must appreciate you that this factor you have. For example, you said about potato, perfectly right. If we do not have proper potatoes for chip making, I think the normal potatoes would not. Fortunately, our central potato research institute in Shimla have done very wonderful work. We are the highest producer of potatoes in the world. But now they have varieties which are processing time. And I think they are now helping to have product. And you as well, there are pulses, very right. I remember there was a demand earlier about what they call it as onion, dehydrated onion. And then it was a lot of Arab countries and many countries, they want dehydrated onion. None of our varieties were suitable for dehydration. It's very, very funny. Because the TSS used to be very low. The total sugar content used to be less than 18%. So Therefore, what we need is, I would go back to this. I would say that the food industry people should now come up with what kind of varieties they need. Because unless you, because I am from agricultural research system, and we know that we have 103 agricultural institutions federal and 74 universities in the country. And in addition to that, there are many private people who are working. But my issue is that we are, until now, we were only concentrating on quantity. Our all measurement of releasing a variety was based on weight. I think that is wrong. Now we have to see that we produce, the farmers produce, but then they must get. For example, I am a cotton man. If I get very good high level of cotton, if I want, which we are importing rather extra long staple cotton, but we are not producing it. But then if we produce it, can our industry be able to buy? So I think this is what is, you have very rightly there. And as you said, fruits and vegetables, there's a tremendous scope, but we have to improve our pre, post harvest management, transport management, everything. Now, thank you very much. We will come back. I would request those who are interested in questions, kindly write them in the chat box and give it to Vibha. Vibha will ultimately finalize them. I would now request Krishna. I think Krishna Narvade is from Patanjali Ayurveda. And Patanjali has a very, very big scope now in almost all. I was the other day very happy to see Patanjali's store in one of the airports, which has all those products which are displayed. And it is not that in Delhi T2 airport you will find that people are rushing to Patanjali store. So Krishna, I must compliment. Now I would like you to tell us in 20 minutes, what are those you have in mind in Ayurveda? So that, and also, as I think Sanjeev has suggested, what kind of raw material you need for that? Please, Krishna Narvade from Patanjali. You are kindly unmute. Please go ahead. Yeah,
you can hear me now?
Yeah.
Thank you, Maisa. Thank you, Agro Food Exhibition and entire team for giving Patanjali opportunity to have a few words regarding the food techniques and food processing and status and the needs required. Actually, it is very vast subject as such discuss. Sanjeev ji has also discussed very short, because 20 minutes is very less as compared to topic consideration. I would like to take this into a very different way and focus on different factors what Patanjali is actually working, because if you see how and why Patanjali has grown such a big organization and reached to each man, each individual person to provide their products, food products in each sector, not one sector, in each sector. Maybe it is a spice, maybe it is a candies, maybe it is Ayurveda juice, maybe it is Ayurvedic tablets, which gives a beneficial to the people. The reason is that it is well planned, well organized, and well executed. And personally, Swamiji taken it to the people by different means, like yoga and other things. They have given the importance of the each and everything of their products produce. So coming to the topic, food technology is a very vast subject as such, which has started actually working in the food industry from 18th centuries. Scientists started working on studying the food products, converting them into a value added or making into a semi-finished product or finished product. So basically, food technology is a science which deals with the techniques and principle involved in processing and preserving the food substances, which convert into a value-added food safe product to the industry, to the human beings. So that is the food technology. Coming to the food processing, which is converting a raw material, raw food into a finished product, which can add a value to the product, give the energy, give the safe food, and convert into a final product, which can give a shelf life free from microorganisms, any chemical changes, and safe for human consumption. Now coming to the food processing sector, which is actually divided into four parts. Basically, agricultural produce, which is a very huge 70%, we can call coming from the agricultural produce, which includes all grains, vegetable, fruits, vegetables, spices, legumes, and herbal products, herbal produce basically. Now I would like to add much more on this chapter, agricultural produce, and I would like to request the Honorable Minister also and Dr. Saab to take this topic to the ministry as well as to the industrialist basically. I am working in this industry from last 25 years and basically I am finding the gap. See, processing is not a very big problem in the industry because a lot of techniques has been developed, like HITS processing, irradiation, cold chain processing. These are techniques are proven techniques that is there. My request, Sanjeev ji also has put a very minute thing on it, but he should take this topic a little bit different, but time binding is the constraint. I would like to give a focus on the agricultural produce from farm, how to collect it, how to handle it properly and provide it to the processing industry. I think ministry has needs to work on this field basically. Whatever the agricultural produce, most of the produce get damaged or spoiled, or maybe not knowing of techniques to process it, to handle it, to supply to the industry. I would like to add here, if ministry try to put their efforts and try to invest in that sector, like a cluster, MSME clusters, like after harvesting, immediately grade this produce, the high A grade, you can supply it to the table variety, and B grade, D grade, C, you can take it for the processing purpose. Dr. Saab, you have raised one point during your lecture that due to the climatic situations, a lot of changes, a lot of losses had happened. But I would like to take it into a different manner. We should take and learn from this that we should focus on this factor, even though like now mango processing will start in April, and in basically March, February, there are a lot of storms and other things which damage the mangoes, the fruits, which a little bit immature condition or ready to get matured. So if we focus on this, even though the farmer will not get a cash impact on their or their profit or their loss, whatever. So if ministry focus on that factors also to put a small processing units or semi-finished products, like collect these fruits which drops because of the storms or some climatic conditions, and make it into a valuable product, like crush them and make a chutneys, green chutneys, which also can help to add in the finished products like beverages to give a different taste, different value addition Like a mango chutney is possible, mango, green mango pulp, which helps for adding in a finished product of the beverages, pet bottles, juices, drinks, 100% juices. So this is not a problem in my view, which Swamiji always focus on such topics. He always discuss there is no problem, always there are, if there is a problem, there is always solution. So I think we should focus on that factor. In India, actually, very good opportunities for food processing and utilizing food techniques to convert into a valuable products. India has got a very high sources of the agricultural produce, animal produce, sea produce, compared to the world production. We have to see and observe the gaps where we are lacking behind. We are lacking behind in the planning. We are lacking behind in the utilization of the raw material, supply of the raw material, and making into a valuable products. Coming to the scope, almost 10% of the produce which now India produce getting processed. So there are a lot of chances of converting this agricultural produce and giving benefits to the farmer, to the nation, make in India, and make this government slogan, that we can prove it by focusing on different topics like agricultural. There itself, it should handle and try to convert into a semi-finished product or make it suitable to give it to the industry, so industry can convert into a valuable product. Second, I would like to add one more thing. The grains, which generally spoils because of a lot of thing, infestation, diseases, and that things. So lot of techniques are now developed by the industry, by the engineers, by the food technologies, to store this into a silos, big silos, where we can save our land also, we can save the money, we can save the time, and we can save the product, means the whatever the agricultural produce, the grain, pulses, legumes, that can be stored in a good silos. We can give infestation techniques, we can reduce the moisture content. Lot of facilities are now available. So ministry can focus on this chapter also by providing the general warehouses all over India and focusing on that. Now, if ministry has put and start giving support on providing the big silos, like 1 lakh ton, 2 lakh tons at a different isolated and design. Jo bhi hai, jo find out karke, that we can store the grains for the year. Now, Patanjali, if you come, I will invite Dr. Saab to the Patanjali to see the storage facilities also. We have a very big silo where we can store the grains and we can consume these grains during the whole year for the production of the atta and other products. Secondly, the inert storages, like we always talk on the, there is always loss to the farmer on the vegetable, 30% handling losses, everything. So like a potato, it can be stored for the whole year, like same vegetable, tomato also can be stored for 2-3 months. Horticulture board already has worked on these different vegetables and fruits, how they can store for long time. So in India, if you see the conditions, it is a very short season. Like a mango season is 1.5 months, 2 months. Tomato season is also 2 months. So during that time, the climatic condition arises and it vanishes the crop.
So here also there is a possibility to store this, if such situation arises, we can collect the fruit, sort it properly and try to store it inert storages for at least 2-3 months, and in off season you can sell it to the market or you can provide it to the food industry by just adding whatever 1-1.5 rupees storage cost. So it is a feasible to process these products. Next to this, I would like to discuss on why food processing industry is important. Definitely it is very important because it is an intermediate for the farmer and the end consumer. So food processing industry is already working on different factors in automation, developing a well-designed modular equipments which can convert this product to the value-added products. Sanjeev already told that food processing is a sunrise sector. Definitely in India, it is 100% sunrise sector. Lot of chances are there to convert this agricultural produce, animal produce, seed produce to a valuable product to export purpose. India produces spices, all spices, grains, rice, which is the first or second in the world. But we are very back under processing and converting into valuable products. Now coming to a short, because time is also a limit. I would like to focus on the status and needs. Needs to the industry is basically status is very good at present. We are a well organized sectors in food industry. We are processing products into semi-finished product or a very high value product by adding vitamins and minerals to end consumer. Day by day, demand is also getting changed in the food industry. That is also a basic problem for the entrepreneur to invest in the industry. But definitely it is a challenge, but industry is also accepting that challenge, and day by day they are improving their quality, hygiene, HACCP is incorporated in the system. Pesticide also getting analyzed and try to reduce it in the finished product. Now, government also, it is a request from Patanjali also, and from the infrastructure development, road facilities, basically the water water provision, because see, finally everything get accounted into a final cost. And due to all these climatic changes and this, the product cost goes up always. There is no stable, steady movement of the final product cost. So definitely it is a challenging job as such as on date, but the food industry required basically the power, basically the road, transport facilities, manpower, water. These are the basic things required for the industry to run it very well. And as on date, government from last 4-5 years has focused well to provide a support in this respect to the industry. Coming to the conclusion, MSME part, what government is now focusing on that, if this MSME sector directly focus at the Gramin level to the village level and try to convert this whatever produce to make it into a semi-finished product, would help industry to survive. So here Nagpur Food Park, it is my region actually. I'm from the Nagpur basically. So I always have eager to start this orange processing plant, which is 800 metric tons per day capacity processing. Here we have, see, one more point I would like to add and put my input to the food industry, that food industry will never survive if the product converted into a finished product
basic finished product, like for example, mango convert to the mango pulp. The food industry need to focus, because Swamiji has focused on that, to convert into each and every part of the food to a finished product. So at Nagpur Patanjali, the orange pulp or orange juice concentrate is not a single product. We have put our very broad view and we try to set up a industry here to convert the orange peels to into value-added products like for cosmetic, medicine purpose. The oil coming out of the peel, which is also has a very good Ayurvedic properties as well as medicinal properties. So we are also putting that facility to convert into a value-added product. Coming to the mango, the seed can be converted, peel can be converted. And even though if it is, we could not able to convert or utilize 100%, that can be converted into a fuel energy where you can reduce your product cost or processing cost to a minimal level. So this is two inputs I would like to conclude at the end of my discussions. Government, if try to focus at the farm level for handling their produce, converting into a semi-finished or value-added, or if possible to store it in inert storage, that would also add and return to the farmer and also support to the food industry to survive in that respect. Second, the inner storage and the grain storages, because this topic is very huge to discuss in each and every field. So I would like to conclude, and these two points, if government has taken into consideration, would help industry as well as farmer to recover their values to into our money. Thank you, Dr. Sahab.
Thank you, entire team.
Thank you,
Dr. Krishna Naravade.
Yeah,
I think you have given a very broad view as to what is happening in Patanjali and where you are heading it. I am happy that you are from Nagpur. We are waiting for your plan of origin. Because I am from agriculture side. We have an institute on citrus here. And also PDKB Akola is working at Katol on this particular fruit for a long time. Everybody has claimed that this particular fruit is not suitable for processing. But I think, as you have very rightly pointed out, the peels can be very well utilized of these fruit. I think you said that they can be used in cosmetics. I remember one of the products which our people have prepared is the soap out of this field. So there could be lots of cosmetic products which have come.
Yeah.
So I'm happy that you have projected a very nice picture as to started with the 18th century. See, food industry, as you said, is a very old concept in India. But it is to be a very domestic and a homely affair. Every family in the dryland agriculture knew that there is going to be a, what we need to have some food during the rains and summer. So that's why they used to have kurdayas and papads and so many other products we used to have. So it's not new. Now what we are interested in is that now this has to be taken on a little commercial scale so that the world and the farmers get benefit out of it. I remember one of our products which is prepared out of jawar bread. I was surprised. You will be surprised that one of our Marathi student, he went first time to Europe, to America. And he was so disturbed that there is no food in America because most of the bread is unprocessed. Oh, he said he came back. And, I was surprised. He gave a report to us that there is a food shortage in America. So basically what he was accustomed to eat is jawar roti, dal and chutneys, which is not available there, you see. So yeah. This could be a sort of an anecdote, but the point of telling is that our food habits and other things have become, now over a period of time, we need to change them. And we need to have focus. I'm happy that Patanjali is concentrating on herbal products. I think this is another very important area that we are looking, because I am working on a project in Gadchiroli. Probably you know Gadchiroli.
Yeah.
Tribal area, 80% tribal area, and a lot of forest products and herbal areas are there. There are Vaidus who are already doing some of those things which are related. We have even organized a conference of Vaidus. What is, but they don't tell you what exactly is, what kind of herbal, what kind of pain or what kind of disease they should be using. But I think now the time has come. Yeah, please.
I am also working on that area to convert this product to a value-added product and herbal products.
Very good.
The Gadchiroli and Chandrapur. Whenever next time we will get a time, specific subjects we can discuss, like spices also. There are a lot of development had happened, like in Nagpur also. We don't know. We are just focusing on the orange. Definitely orange is a good product. And Patanjali is taking care of this year to make it into juices, its oil, its shreds and value-added product. But there are other products also grown in Vidarbha, like a red chili, tomato. Tomato, you know, it is a very high quality tomato of giving a high color value compared to anywhere in India.
Yeah.
I have processed this tomato 3-4 years back. It is a very, very good source of good quality of tomato with the high lycopene, high Brix. So there would be a good return to the farmer.
Yeah, yeah. So my point is that it's a very, it's a huge field. Like you will be also happy to know that my colleagues, I am also president of another association who has a product, we have a project from DBT working in Rajasthan on these seed spices. Very surprised.
Yeah.
They call it as Kisan Hub. We are trying to improve the productivity of isabgol, coriander, cumin, and so many other these things. So that is an area where there is very potential. And you will be very happy to see what happens in India, that if you have desert area and arid areas, you have different kind of plants which are growing. And if you go to south, there is a different kind of spices. You have miris and black pepper and so many other things. So India is actually a very rich diversity, and that diversity we must be able to utilize. I am happy that in Patanjali.
Dr. Sir, one more point I would like to add here. In this food park developed by me only, it is almost 300 acre. And for your kind information, we are also putting a fruit processing plant here where you can process each and every fruit, like a pomegranate, mango, tomato, loki, karela, everything, herbal products as well. And it is a 600 ton capacity. I believe and I trust that we can support by developing this food park to the entire Vidarbha farmers and to produce their whatever the chilies and tomatoes, mangoes, loki and gopla, everything.
So thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think you support AgroVision's contingent because it is in Nagpur located. Now, once again, thank you. And now we proceed further. We have amongst us Ranveer Nagaich. Is he around here, Ranveer Nagaich?
Yes, sir. Good afternoon. Yes, sir.
Ranveer, thank you very much for coming. You are in the Niti Aayog. Earlier, it used to be Planning Commission. I was agriculture commissioner when I used to come very frequently to your planning commission those days. Anyway, but now you are in Niti Aayog. I'm happy that you are going to speak to us about the policy. It's a very important area. How do we promote the entire food sector now? Because this is the need of, Corona has taught us that what we need is the food preservation, conservation, food processing and kindly give your views of this.
Sure. So thank you so much, sir, for inviting me, and thank you to the AgroVision Foundation. I'll just touch on a lot of the speakers before, sir. Sanjeev Gupta, sir, and Narvade, sir, have raised very pertinent issues in terms of food processing. So I'd just like to start off. Narvade, sir, had said that less than 10% of the output is processed, but it also varies within commodities. So for example, in fruits and vegetables, it's about 2%. In poultry, it's 6%, but it's higher in meat, marine, and milk products. But at the same time, most of the processing that we do in India is of primary processing, which have low value addition. So there's a real need to move up the value chain as well. So in terms of policy, I think the government of India over the past few years has recognized that the agriculture policy paradigm that we had set up in the 1960s, such as the Green Revolution, setting up the Food Corporation of India, so and so, they were designed in a time to combat shortages, as you rightly said, sir. And now the focus has shifted to surplus management. And so we need to plan accordingly, and definitely processing and also exports will play a huge role in this aspect. And one thing I'd like to add, sir, in when we're discussing technologies and we're talking about what technologies to use, I feel a lot of it should be demand driven. Example, exporters, if they want to export mangoes to Japan or the EU, they'll have to use technologies that are specific to that particular demand. And let's say in terms of processed food as well, consumer demand that is shifting towards more healthier food and more healthier options. So vacuum frying is one option that contains lower fat. So the technologies that we employ, as everyone has rightly said, they do exist, but entrepreneurs and will need to select technologies based on the demand of their final product and their target markets. And in context, why I'm mentioning entrepreneurs is that the government of India, not just in agriculture, food processing, but in manufacturing and other sectors, is increasingly recognizing the private sector as a leader and who's going to lead the transformation. So any transformation in the agriculture and food processing sector together will have to be private sector driven. So in terms of the policies, I think everyone is aware of the Kisan Sampada Yojana run by the Food Processing Ministry. Then we also more recently announced the PM formalization for micro enterprises scheme to formalize the informal food processing enterprises. And in this context, the unorganized segment tends to outnumber the organized segment in food processing. So bringing the unorganized sector, informal organized sector into the formal fold is one of our key policy goals as well. And this 10,000 crore rupees outlay over 5 years is aimed exactly at that. And also the speakers had spoken of infrastructure, completely agree. There was a complete lack of investment at the farm gate in infrastructure in managing post-harvest losses. Someone pointed out post-harvest losses annually, ICAR had estimated, or an institute of ICAR had estimated that we lose up to 90,000 crores a year in post-harvest losses in terms of horticulture products. So definitely, and I think I would like to reiterate that it's the private sector led investment, private sector led growth model that the food processing industry will have to will follow, because that's where the know-how, like Narvade sir from Patanjali was telling us, that's where the lot of know-how and the technicalities and the experience comes from, and what sort of products to develop, how to partner with farmers. And in partnering with farmers, I'd like to bring to the attention the scheme for 10,000 FPOs. So as we all know, most of 85% of farmers in India are small and marginal farmers. So reaching these farmers individually, connecting to them for companies was a cost which discouraged processing. Now aggregating farmers through farmer producer organization, where the spirit of cooperatives that we saw succeed in milk back in the day, and with professional management, tie-ups to industry, then we'll see a lot of these backward linkages develop. So a reason why we didn't have a lot of processable varieties, why farmers weren't growing them, was because of the demand chain was broken. Now that the government last year, they introduced the new farm laws, and a lot of states have amended their APMC acts as well. So that will promote better integration between food processors and farmers. I mean, Pepsi, for example, is already partnering with farmers across India to grow processable variety of potatoes. So similar partnership will be made possible through that. And again, in terms of technologies, the government, sir, you had mentioned about quality of produce. So in terms of that, the government, Niti Aayog, we're taking a few initiatives to establish to use technologies to establish traceability. Again, I'm coming back to the demand point. For example, consumers in urban areas such as New Delhi, Mumbai, Bangalore, metropolitan areas where a lot of the high value demand comes from, they're increasingly demanding traceability. They want to know where the food has come from, what the nutritional value is, whether it's organic, and they want it to be verified. So one such application of technology here is blockchain. So here at Niti Aayog, we're piloting two projects, one for Apple's establishing a traceability mechanism for Apple's in Himachal Pradesh. And this is again in partnership with a startup based out of Bangalore and the government of Himachal Pradesh. And we're also working with this startup called Milk Mantra, which is based in Odisha. So they are establishing a traceability system for milk using blockchain. So these are such initiatives, again, which will only come through the private sector expertise. So we were in a group with ITC, Mr. Sanjeev Puri had said that a lot of these solutions do exist in India, but they tend to exist in silos and they lack scale. So the real need is to scale up these solutions, make them applicable to all over India. And in this context, the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, they are putting together what is called the Unified Farmer Services Platform, which is basically an underlying data platform on which the private sector can build technological solutions in and deliver them to farmers through startups. So it'll have a lot, it'll have the soil health card data, it'll have insurance data, it'll have PM Kisan data. So it'll have a lot of data that we can use to develop models. For example, another pilot that we are working on with the private Big Basket is to develop a production and price prediction system for the tomato crop as well. So these are just some examples of frontier technologies that can be employed. And also in terms of processing the backward linkages that are being enabled also now through the Agriculture Infrastructure Fund. There's a 1 lakh crore Agriculture Infrastructure Fund that has been launched. And it is aimed at creating this sort of farm gate infrastructure, the link infrastructure that has so far been missing from India. While we went ahead and created a lot of coal storages, sir, in 2015, there was a report by the National Center for Coal Chain Development. So it had estimated the total amount of coal stored we would require. So if you would check those numbers, we are broadly at that requirement. But what we have lacked in is the intermediate steps to complete the coal chain, which is hampering our processing capability as well. So example, pack houses, very important in terms of horticulture products, where the products are sorted, they're graded and packed accordingly, according to the temperatures and stored properly, and also refrigerated vehicles. That's another big gap in India. I mean, not very technologically advanced, but it's still a gap that we need to fulfill before we can think of getting into export markets and developing other processable varieties as well. So again, I'd like to reiterate that the government has initiated a lot of schemes, but these schemes are built on enabling the private sector to unleash the true potential of India's food processing, be it in value addition, be it in employment, which, as the previous speakers have said, hold tremendous importance in the Indian economy. So it's, and then we have the production linked incentive scheme for food processing as well. So again, the thrust of the government is focusing towards value addition in terms of fisheries. Also, there's been a new scheme launched. So the all around focus is value addition, but enabled by creating an enabling environment for the private sector to thrive and to create the sort of infrastructure we need in the backward linkages, because the quantum of investments required, if the government decides to undertake them, may take much longer to realize because of the sheer competition for resources that the government faces as well. So what we need is the private sector to take a leading role in this. The government is ready with all handholding support. A number of schemes have been launched in terms of infrastructure, in terms of providing incentives to the private sector. So really, I think the government has quite rightfully focused on value addition and creating an enabling infrastructure and environment for the private sector to thrive.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. I think you have given a very wonderful view, Ranveer, about the policies, which you have very rightly said that generalization making as a 10% processing may not be correct, but I think we'll have to concentrate into areas where there has been a lack. For example, as you said, that fruits and vegetables, we have only 2% which are basically converted into the product, primary processing. And then we are already losing something like 90,000 crore only on the losses in fruits and vegetables. So it appears that there is a mismatch, and I think where to concentrate for a private industry. Another very important factor which we are saying is the government and creating an enabling environment. Enabling environment for of policy for promotion of private sector to enter. So that this is very important. I think these are what we call it as the real areas, because we were all the way considered earlier private sector to be sort of untouchable for this. But now this is very important, that unless new investment comes, so if you take about cold storage and you talked about a blockchain and all these, there it is very important that we really concentrate on the private sector to really come up. Another policy issue which I think you have thrown light on, there are lots of unorganized sectors which possibly would like to bring it in organized. I think this is also a very good initiative. And the traceability, I think now, because I've been connected to a lot of export activities, we find that traceability has become almost universal, because people would like to know, even in grapes, we have done a wonderful job in grape export, mainly because of the fact of traceability. So we know from which field the grapes are coming and what kind of sprays he has already done, so that there is no residue. So all these issues are now, I think, finding time. And I'm happy that you have initiated the initiatives of blockchain in Apple in Himachal Pradesh, milk in Orissa. I think these would be setting an example in future. So thank you very much. I think we had a wonderful, messages which you have given. Now I come down to, there may be a few questions at the end. I'm not yet, I have not seen the chat box, but it will come. Ramesh Srivastava. Ramesh Srivastava is around there?
Ramesh? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I
am. Ah, Ramesh. So welcome, Ramesh Srivastava. Ramesh Srivastava is from the Central Institute of Medicinal and Aromatic Plants, a very important institute. Short form? CMAP.
CMAP, right? Yeah. Yes, CMAP. Yes, sir. Yes.
And you are in Lucknow or in Bangalore?
No, sir. I am in Lucknow headquarters.
At headquarters, because you have another research institute in Bangalore and Hyderabad. What else? You have another third, I think.
Yes, sir. One is in Pantnagar and other one is Purara, Bageshwar.
Where is that? Bageshwar?
Bageshwar, Uttarakhand. Uttarakhand.
Uttarakhand. Very good. So I think the very important institute of CSIR. We are in Nagpur and we know only Navy. But I think you are quite. Ramesh, we have lots of areas, possibly because even after this webinar, I will be contacting you. As sir, you know, Maharashtra government has done a very important job. We have given a lot of funding to the medicinal aromatic plant projects, even the germplasm, then preservation, conservation of all these tribal areas of Gadchiroli, then the Western Ghats and everything. We would like to now really compile this information as to what can be the ultimately useful for the general body. Maharashtra is already doing a lot of research in this area, so definitely I will come after. But before that, I would request you to kindly highlight us as to how food processing industry, particularly food technology, can help through your PMAP in our city. Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you, sir. Respected Mai sir and the organizers of this Agri Vision concepts. I would like to thank all the organizers and sir, respected sir, to invite us for participating in this webinar. Actually, that this CMAP is working on especially on medicinal and aromatic plants. And like sir told that we have four centers. Lucknow is headquarter, and apart from Lucknow, we have four centers situated in all India for conducting our trials in different agroclimatic zones. So our first center is in Pantnagar, that is famous as a Dawai farm in Pantnagar, just front of the Pantnagar University. Another farm, another research is, center we have in Bangalore. It is nearby to airport. And third one is in Hyderabad. CMAP Research Center is in Hyderabad. And fourth one is in Purara. It is situated in district Bageswar. Earlier it was in district Almora, but now the Bageswar is made new district by the government of Uttarakhand, and it is in Uttarakhand. So sir, we have four centers situated for development of new varieties, new agro technologies, new processing technologies for the especially medicinal and aromatic plant. Apart from these centers, we have developed number of technologies which is used by the farmers of Maharashtra, farmers of all over India. And I would like to inform you that in 2017 we have one very important mission program that called Aroma Mission. That Aroma Mission program was run by our institute. Apart from our institute, more four institutes like IIIM Jammu and NIST Jorhat, NBRI Lucknow, they all institutes are supporting to the farmers in the form of plant good planting material. Even the group of the farmers, we also provided the distillation unit for primary processing, because the primary processing is the very essential for the cultivation of the aromatic crops. So in Aroma Mission phase one, means 2017 to 2019, we have developed more than 1400 farmers cluster, because we have developed these clusters among all in 24 states of India, and for the developing their farm income. So in that farm income, we have planted menthol mint, we have planted spearmint, we have planted lemongrass, palma roja, citronella. So these are the main aromatic crops which enhance the farmer's income. Even in Sir Gadchiroli, we have also selected, and we have worked with that paper industry that it is situated in this region. So we supported especially tribal farmers, especially poor farmers, for doubling their farm income through Aroma Mission. And from this in January 2021, we have also granted one this same program, Aroma Mission Part 2, and we are supporting the farmers for providing the training for development of the quality planting material, for development of the quality produce which can be used for the aroma industry, for food industry, for flavor industry, because these essential oils cannot be directly used by the consumer. It can be used through the processing, primary processing and secondary processing, for making flavors, because this session is especially for food. So, and we have developed good nutraceutical products like Patanjali. Dr. Sanjeev Gupta and Dr. Krishna was also told that after processing we can have the value, that value can be fetched by the farmers after the processing. So in food, in nutraceutical industry, we have supporting about 4-5 industry for production of the one product we have developed, that is proprietary medicine, that is proprietary formulation for chaman pras, named Sim Pausak. In Sim Pausak, we have the ingredient is about four ingredient like all medicinal plants. Another one is Sim Phalse. So there are two nutraceutical products which is already developed by our institute, and that is available for technology transfer. Apart from these two nutraceutical products, we have developed number of products for the industry. Like we have developed products of hair care, disinfectant, mosquito repellent, pain relieving, skin care technologies in COVID management. Recently, we have developed one very good product that is diffuser based product, especially for COVID. That kills all the microbes available in the environment, including virus, COVID virus. So that technology is going to be transferred to the railways for sanitizing the railway coaches. So actually, this is the whole technology developed by our institute through scientific approach. But the Phalse, that is our nutritive granules. This Phalse is a nutritive formulation developed by our institute. It is Ayurvedic knowledge-based formulation providing the benefits of high-value fruits of amla and dill. So amla fruits is a rich, as you know, amla fruits are rich in natural source of vitamin C and trace minerals, adding the antioxidant sources. And the bale fruit is rich in source of carbohydrate and pectins, nutritional fiber, facilitating the digestion ability of the body. This product, this formulation is prepared to be taken orally as a chewable food value supplement, which can enhance the immunity, even immunity potential of the body, besides providing the benefit of the nutritionally rich ingredient. So this is the very good formulation, and this technology was transferred to two industries, and they are making for the commercialization. The another product that I have already discussed, that is Sim Pausak, is a rasayana based immunomodulator in the form of Paulay formulation containing 12 well known powerful Ayurvedic ingredients, which with phyllanthus like amla as the base. All ingredients are individually known for their nutritive value. In combination, the formulation renders as the harmonizing energy, leading to better metabolism. So these are the, and we are also working to for another nutritive products like development of some buns. Because we have one nutraceutical mission product project, in that we have developed number of products, but these products are under evaluation by our committee. Apart from these, we have developed the number of varieties of medicinal plants which are cultivated by the farmers of India. And we have developed varieties in Vidania somnifera. Recently, we have developed and popularizing among the growing areas of the Ashwagandha. And a number of varieties has been developed by the Osmum Sanctum. Then Plantago Aveta, this Isab Gold variety we have developed. Then Sena varieties we have developed and commercially cultivated by the farmers. Then Asparagus. The Satavari variety was also developed by our scientist named Sunehri. And we did very good work in development and commercialization of this Artemisia annua. Okay. And recently, we have developed one very good product, this Sim Andro. And that product is for the COVID-19. And that clinical trial is going on with three medical colleges. For the commercialization. That product has already been transferred to one industry based at Lucknow. So these are the technologies available with the CMAP, and CMAP is always welcome to the farmers for providing the training, for providing the technologies, and providing the processing units for their income enhancement. So these are the technologies, and you all are welcome in our this mission program. And we have a team of the scientists who is supporting the farmers, especially in Maharashtra. And our local coordinating unit is in Neri. So Neri is also supporting us for extension of the aromatic crops in the area. So these are the technologies and product services providing to the farmers of the of India for enhancing their income for betterment of the life. Okay, and number of essential oil and medicinal plant we are importing. So we are also going towards the Atmanirbhar in the field of lemongrass, in the field of palmaroja. Even we are also trying to develop the area in geranium and other products which we are totally importing from the other countries. So these are the products and the technologies which are offering to the farmers for their income enhancement. So thank you very much for giving an opportunity to discuss these products and processing technologies to all of you. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Srivastava, for a very enlightening talk. And you have given an overview as to what the CMAP is already now doing. I'm happy about Aroma Mission, because under this mission, you already formed several clusters, like 1400 clusters. And I think some of them are already in Maharashtra also. I'm also happy that there are a large number of varieties that you are developing, with an object of basically promoting them for the processing, like Sena, Isabgol, Tatavari, and so many other things. Also, your work on the essential oils, particularly lemongrass, geranium, and the thing which you are now trying to see, that we become Atmanirbhar in all these things, where we don't need to import some of the essential oils and other things. I think this is a very commendable thing, because what I find is that this one area, particularly medicinal aromatic plant, actually is considered to be one of the very pioneering areas, I would say, that this sector can really provide a huge kind of employment opportunity for the youngsters. And they need to be really attracted to these, provided we have. Because I remember to have bought one product from NIST, I remember. This is, they call it as, I think, this is kind of thing which is for basically for your knees, where you can use a knee balm. And that was quite effective. I think it was already commercialized. And some that kind of linkage, I must appreciate, particularly CMAP, that it doesn't restrict only for development, but from subsequent development, it must also go to what we call it as the commercial level, where you can tag over some entrepreneurs, you can track the industry or a private fellow who can really take up the technology on a larger scale. We are from ICAR system, ICAR. Now in ICAR, probably you know, we have also done several of these programs, particularly our Kochi, which is basically Institute for Marine Fisheries. Hundreds of products have been developed by them, like shell can and calcium tablets and so many things. So my point is that I think we should all come together now. It's the time that we enhance our activities. So very welcome, Dr. Srivastava. I think with this, we complete actually now the speaker's view. I would like to ask any specific question, particularly first few questions from the speaker themselves. Krishna, you have any questions? Dr. Srivastava, Dr. Sanjay, Sanjay Gupta, and Ranveer. Do you have amongst yourselves any questions? Kindly answer. Then I can ask the participants to give. Vibha, is there around? Vibha?
Yes, sir, I'm around.
Vibha, anything in the chat box? Any questions?
Not yet, sir.
Not yet, okay. That means people are very happy that the presentations have been so effective that they can now follow. Any? If there are none, I would like to really ask Dr. Srivastava, is there any database of medicinal and aromatic plants in India? Any special database?
Yes, sir. We have database of all the medicinal and aromatic plant which is grown by the farmers of India, and what quantity we are exporting, what quantity we are importing. We have some database. I can share you, sir. Personally, I can share you.
Okay, that would be very fine.
Thank you, sir.
Right to you, yeah. Because what we are looking into, if there is an Indian database, we need to prepare any state-wise data, because Maharashtra, we are asked to prepare a database. I said that even at the Indian level, if national level, we have a database, there is no necessity to prepare a separate database. That is what my point. That's why I asked. And also the database for the products which are already commercialized. Do we have any, it's not only CMAP, but there are many other institutes which are doing. We have any compiled information on these?
Yes, sir. We actually, our headquarters CSIR has compiled information, because in our institute I have, because I'm looking after technology transfer also. So okay. I can share the CMAPs technology and their transferred and commercialized. But if you want whole CSIR 38 labs database, you just write to Mande sir. He will provide, sir. There is no issue. All the compiled database. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
I would like to.
I would like to also add that database if possible. Yeah. Dr. Srivastava.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Please.
Okay.
Also working on. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Narode, I have one question for you.
Yeah, please.
Because the Patanjali. Now you are in a very wide range of products which you are interested in. Maybe I have said that from medicinal aromatic plants, from herbal products, to you are also going for fruits and vegetables. Patanjali has any very focused area that would like to target this by something like another 5 years or 10 years?
Yeah, Swamiji, actually they have very broad views and study on the agricultural produce, because he is also a farmer basically.
Okay. Yeah.
So he knows very well what is getting produced in India and what are the benefits, where is the we are lacking. So as such, when we discuss in the meeting every month, so Swamiji always focus on two things. One is the food, entire food sector, in the sense it includes spices, health products like a Chyawanprash and Ayurvedic products, digestive products, then medicated juices, even latest technology product like very value added products like 100% juices and fruit drinks. So he focus on the fruit processing, and secondly, his more view on the Ayurvedic products, to develop the Ayurvedic products to extract. We also have a very good extraction system at Haridwar for extracting the natural contents from the herbs and vegetables basically. So we are focusing on both food and herbal products basically.
If Sanjeev Gupta is around, I would like to ask him one question. Sanjeev?
Yes, sir.
Sanjeev, I must compliment you. You have given a very wonderful view of your sunrise sector of food processing. I would just like to say that are there some new technologies which possibly we can directly import from outside for enhancing our food processing? Because it is not that we have all the technology ourselves, but if you find in US or in Europe or in Japan, there are lots of new technologies which are coming, particularly in terms of equipment. You have any idea as to how we can upgrade our business?
Dr. Mai, as you know, the gentleman from NITI Aayog also mentioned, technology is demand driven. And availability of technology is not an issue, according to me. It has to be demand driven, and a lot of technologies are getting imported and getting installed also. Gentleman from Patanjali is also here. He can also give his views. Availability of technology is not an issue at all. It is the question of, you see, the food processor. Food processor is going to adopt the technology based on the success of his venture. Whether he feels this venture is going to be a successful venture or not. Today, the biggest challenge for big time operators are consistent quality of raw material availability. He doesn't want to spend his resources and time and effort in standardizing the quality of raw material, because inconsistent quality of raw material can also make a technology fail. That is also a very big challenge. Yeah. I think what we need to focus is the quality management of the raw material at the farm level. That is where I think we need the major focus. And I repeat, let there be a technology demand for any particular solution, we will be able to provide it either indigenous or imported. And in many cases, both are available. It all depends upon the scale of operations, because Indian technologies basically have still not reached a very high scale of operation. That is one area. Thank you.
No, Sanjeev, you are perfectly right. You said that possibly what we need to have quality material which should be available. There is another reverse signaling. When we discuss with farmer, they say, can we get good returns out of it? Because what happens is, if I want to have a very good quality material for them, they have to little invest. And they say that they are not getting that return. For example, if you take the varieties of wheat which is grown in Punjab, they may not be all very useful. But varieties which are grown in the other areas like Vidarbha, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, which are in high demand of wheat because they are of quality. But then the prices of these are very high. So there is what they say, that the industry must also support us, that there should be some kind of a, may not be a guarantee, but some kind of an understanding that, okay, we provide you what quality you needed, provided we get better return. How this can be done through either an FPO or something, I think the Planning Commission is already thinking of farming this FPO. Now they can be very well traced. What is your opinion?
Yeah, Dr. Bhai, you see, wherever an industry gets involved, there are cases and case histories where the realization of the farmer has become better. Case in point is processable variety of potato.
Yeah.
Now, I'll give you a little more detail on that. You know, for making the processable variety of potato, the quality of the potato seed has to be different, had to be different, which was developed in India with active collaborations with the CPRI and people from Netherlands, basically. And they developed LR variety and a few other varieties. Then what happened? When it was seen that this variety of potato is available in India, the food processors got interested in making investments to process that variety and make a snack or whatever. Now, this variety of potato has got two elements which the processor wants. One is the dry matter and the other is the size. Now, what happened that dry matter is available, but in certain cases, the size is lower than what is required. So that becomes a waste. If that becomes a waste, again, the question of economics comes into play, that whether the right realization for the total produced in average is coming or not. So then the technology came into the picture. What was the technology? That we can even use the smaller varieties of potato to make a different product known as potato flakes.
Yeah.
And as a result, 100% of the produce which the farmer is making on demand of the industry is getting totally consumed at a good realizable value. Everything is getting realized, and industry made investments at near the farm for grading of potatoes, brought in the cold storage technology, because for processable variety of potatoes, we don't require sub-zero conditions. We require 6 to 8 degrees conditions. Now that technology was brought in and investment was done at or near the farm level. And the ultimate processor got involved in backing up those people so that there is no problem. Similarly, the government has announced various schemes, cold chain scheme, etc. My own thinking is that if there is a handholding where the investment by the private sector happens or gets a fillip at the farm level, where the produce of the farmer can realize a better value by creating some better infrastructure, either of storage or of some cleaning and grading, or growing of a variety which is required by the industry to process, for which the right seed is provided, that is really going to help the farmer. That is really going to help the whole segment. I think this is where I think there is a missing link, and this is where I always say that the holistic approach is required, that we should target that area, and some very specific schemes, if it is, can be developed by the government, Niti Aayog, etc. You will have people like Patanjali or other or ITC or others who will not shy away from making investments if they can get a better variety of raw material. And it will have an addition into total value chain, including investments in the processing. You see, I also run a private company. My company's name is Kanchan Metals. I also not only make machines, I also run two factories of processed food also. So we know this is what it, I think my own perception is that this is where the focus is required.
Sanjeev, you have given a correct example of potato. I think I am very happy that this is going to be very correct example for really for other things which people want to improve upon the entire food process. Thank you very much. I think we have come.
I also focus on the same topic. The potato is one of the thing, but the agricultural produce is highly perishable as such.
Yeah.
And definitely it is not a one-person job or a government job. It is a responsibility of the government as well as the entrepreneur. Because then in that case, the farmer also get benefited very well. And in that case, A-grade definitely should go for the market. And from B grade to D grade, whatever industry will accept for processing, definitely.
Thank you. I think thank we you, had a very you. Lively session. I would like to really thank Sanjeev Gupta, Krishna, Ranveer Nagayat, and Ramesh Srivastava. We have come to the end because now we are going for the second session. Vibhaji, May I hand over the now mic to you?
Well, thank you. Thank you, Dr. Maya, and all speakers for this informative session. Thank you very much once again.
Thank you, Vibha. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, AgriVision Foundation.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.